And Mary had a son who moved out and never called. Mother's Day for Mary was a tear-filled day, as she hoped that her son would call, hoped that there'd be contact, and too often there was no contact. And so she's a part of our staff at the church there, and we'd have our preparation for Mother's Day, and she'd always want to remind us, for some moms, this is not a fun day. This is a day of lost expectations, of unmet expectations. This is a day of pain. Mary felt bad about that she must have somehow failed her son. And that's why there was no ongoing contact. So she beat herself up, and that would especially happen at Mother's Day. She wanted so much to see this child of her own offspring, and yet he was rejecting her. And that troubled her and wounded her. And Mary helps me remember that Mother's Day is not always a pleasant day for everybody. In fact, the other side of the coin may be true. You may be Mary's son. Why did he leave? He felt rejected at times, felt judged, felt the expectations of a Christian home were too great upon him. Some of you might have grown up in a home like mine. I was at 2 years old. My brother was born. My sister was 14 months older. I was 14 months younger than her. And my brother was born 14 months after me. So there were three children under 2 years old. I now understand why I'm closer to my grandma than my mother, because I went to grandma's house. Brenda stayed there. She had asthma and oftentimes would end up in the hospital, so she got a lot of attention. David was the youngest, and so he had his needs. And so Willie got closer to grandma. We also grew up in a German background. Any of you had that experience? The kind of experience where they don't say, I love you. You're just supposed to know it, right? and on top of that, my mom, I guess there's no better way to say it than be straightforward. My mom had emotional, psychological needs. Life was hard at times for mom, and challenging. And so it was hard for her to express love because she had such need to be loved and such expectations of that. And that made life sometimes challenging as a child and even as a grown-up. I remember the day I get kicked out of my mom's house. Yeah, there's quite a story with that one. But Tim was 4 years old. Debbie's holding him, and my mom had one of her moments and just got extremely angry, upset, went crazy through the house, back and forth from one room into another, accusing me of having left her, which my dad did leave her, and accusing me of having deserted her, which my dad did desert her. And yet I got the privilege of the cursing that day. I guess why I'm sharing this is that some of you have pain in your relationship with your mom, and I understand that. And that pain can come from all kinds of reasons. Christy Wright right now is experiencing her first Mother's Day without her mom. Kathy was only, I think, 54 and died just suddenly here about four weeks ago now at the most. Just died. Kathy struggles and struggled a lot. Her son, Sam, is in a federal penitentiary because of being found guilty of a really pretty nasty murder that took place here on the mountains. Some of you will remember the story. And yet Kathy struggled, suffered, grieved, because her son was in prison and fortunately not given the death sentence, but it was that close. And so the stress, who knows, did that contribute to her death at such an early age? I'll say that as you come to Mother's Day, there's all kinds of emotions present. Some of you have said goodbye to your mom. She's now in heaven. You no longer see her. Regardless of your relationship with your mom, here we are at Mother's Day. It's more than a Hallmark greeting day. It's a time for us to try to understand and recognize and appreciate ladies who have blessed us, sometimes punished us, taught us, stood beside us, and sometimes slammed the door on us too. Because guess what? They are human, just like the rest of us. I think of the fact that my mom was 21 years old with three children under two, and it's no wonder she was crazy. I mean that in a loving way, folks. These ladies who have five, six, seven, eight children all at the same time, Lord, help them. Haven't you ever wondered why the professional football players, you see this again and again, right? It's Super Bowl Sunday, and this camera zooms in on this star athlete, and what does he say? Hi, Mom! Why is that? Why does Mom have this? And by the way, being from the opposite sex, how come they never say, Hi, Dad! Well, you figure that one out. Today, we celebrate the mothers who have influenced our lives, the mothers who have prayed for us, suffered for us, worked for us, and given us life. Incidentally, I've tried to think of the different ones, but don't forget the mother who chose the great sacrifice of allowing her child to be adopted and raised by another. Oh my. We also thank God for those ladies who have been like mothers to us. Our text speaks of an unnamed mother who was recognized for her faith. We pray that God will bless the mothers among us with the faith of that unnamed mom. In our passage, this mother pleads to have Jesus hear her need and free her daughter from a demon. She assesses her daughter's need and believes that Jesus is the best remedy. Persistently, she begs to be heard. Could we say like a nag? And when she worships Jesus, he responds to her faith and heals her daughter. Moms suffer to give us life, and they often suffer because of us. God, speak to us through your word this morning. Please, Lord, we're going to keep praying that you will bless the ladies, that you'll bless the mothers, and you'll bless each child, regardless of age today, with your love and affirmation. In Jesus' name, amen. So I'm going to read to you from Matthew chapter 15, beginning at verse 21. Leaving that place, Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him crying out, Lord, son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is suffering terribly from demon possession. Jesus did not answer a word. So his disciples came to him and urged him, Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us. He answered, I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel. The woman came and knelt before him. Lord, help me, she said. He replied, It is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Yes, Lord, she said, but even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. Then Jesus answered, Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted. And her daughter was healed from that very hour. Folks, we need more prayers, not prayers, more prayers like this mom. We need more people who pray like this mom prayed for her daughter. Jesus, it's interesting, has left Israel. It's the one time he actually leaves Israel. And he travels across. He's now up at the northern part, just outside of Galilee. And he travels up here to the coast, it says, to a little town named Tyre. And Sidon is just above that, maybe about 10 miles. And the people that live there are Canaanites. They're also known as Phoenicians. They were the people that the Jews, I think, disliked more so than the Samaritans. Because these are followers of other gods. They were still in the land, and God had wanted them removed, but they had made some unholy alliances, and they're there. And Jesus has left Israel. Why? Probably to get away from the crowds. Probably just to get a break. Probably to prepare his disciples for what's about to come. Because guess what? Jews aren't going to follow him across the border into Phoenicia. So he can get away from all these crowds that have been following him and wanting him to heal them. And he's going to get a break, and he's going to get some time just to prepare his disciples for what's coming in literally a few months. And that's going to be his death on a cross. I mean, he's getting really close to that now. And so as he goes there, well, guess what? This woman finds out he's coming. And she wants him to heal her daughter who has a demon. Bengel, in his commentary, said, she made the misery of her child her own. Her daughter is suffering because a demon is tearing her up. We don't know how. We don't know what details are going on. But this little girl is in great trauma. And this mom is feeling the pain so much that she's going to do anything she can to get help. And she hears that there's this holy guy, this religious guy, this Jew guy who's coming across the border. And she runs to him and says, please help. It's interesting. She's made an accurate estimation of her daughter's need, hasn't she? We don't know who all she's going to. And they had all kinds of weird type of doctors at that time and different kinds of people that they would go to, different gods and all. But here she's found out that she's heard this guy, even in Phoenicia, they're hearing about this Jesus who's healing people and casting out demons. And he's coming down the road, and she runs to him and says, please heal my daughter. I beg of you, heal my daughter. She's got this demon that's attacking her, and she's suffering. Please heal my daughter. Here's a woman who loves her daughter so much she's willing to go to a foreigner. She's willing to plead with somebody who she believes hates her to try to get help for her daughter. Barclay says, it was love which made her approach this stranger. It was love which made her accept his silence and yet still appeal. It was love which made her suffer the apparent rebuffs. It was love which made her able to see the compassion beyond and behind the words of Jesus. The driving force of this woman's heart was what? Love. And there is nothing stronger and nothing nearer God than that very thing. Don't forget, 1 John says, God is love. But Jesus doesn't respond. She's pleading with him to help. And Jesus doesn't even acknowledge her. No verbal, at least, recognition. Jesus is silent and simply keeps on walking. Sure, have pity, she says. And Jesus moves on. Have you ever felt like Jesus is silent when you pray? What do you do with the silence of God? Now, it's one thing to say, thank you, God, for this day. Thank you for the beautiful life we have here, for the wonderful blue sky out there and all that kind of stuff. And you can kind of say that, and you're okay if it's silent, right? But if you're broken, you're hurting, you've got something heavy that you're carrying, and you go to Jesus with that, Jesus, please. And you're pleading with him. In tears, you're crying out to him. In anguish, you're praying that he'll respond. And it sounds like silence. What do you do? Do you get frustrated? Do you give up? Do you just decide he's not going to respond? He doesn't care. Augustine's mother is named Monica. Monica prayed that her godless boy would not go to Rome because she was afraid that if he went to Rome, all the stuff of Rome would mess him up and he'd be ruined. Well, guess what? God didn't answer her prayer. And Augustine went to Rome. And that's where Augustine accepted Christ as his Lord and Savior. When God's silent, that's when he's listening. Have you ever gone up to somebody and tried to talk to them? Share something that's maybe you're really celebrating something and you come up and you want to tell them this story or you're really broken over something, you're really hurting and you want to share your pain, and as you start to share, they start to talk. And they don't stop. And they even say things like, oh, I know exactly how you're feeling. It's just like when I went through da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And they go on and you're like standing there, but you're not hearing me. There's a reason why God is silent. Because that's when he listens. That's even when he hears our tears. Psalm 22:2. My God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer. By night, but I find no rest. Some would say that that is the psalm that Jesus is quoting as he's hanging on the cross. If you read that psalm and you compare that to what Jesus says as he's hanging from the cross, he cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? He cries out for water, just like in the psalm. And what's Jesus saying as he's hanging there on the cross? God, it's silent right now. See, Jesus definitely understands the silent response when you're in the agony of life. And Jesus is listening. And ladies, if you're burdened today, I need you to know that if you think that Jesus is silent, it's a good thing. Because he's listening. He's listening to your heart. He's listening to your tears as they drop. He's listening to the frustration, the pain, the questions. He's listening to the burden. He's not being silent to ignore you, but he's giving you the opportunity to open your heart to him. Jesus is listening. You see what the woman does? She's cried out, Jesus, have pity on me. In fact, Jesus answers the disciples who come up and say, would you get rid of her, please? You know, just do what she wants, because her nagging, her noise is like getting to us. She's back here at the back, Jesus, and we can't take it anymore. Please just get rid of her. And Jesus responds to the disciples, I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel. That's my mission. I came here to get away from the lost sheep for a few days. I came here for some quiet. That's my purpose. I came on mission to reach Israel, my people, the lost sheep. And the woman comes running up to him at that moment. And what does she do? It says that she kneels down. And Jesus, in front of Jesus, and says, Jesus, please help. Lord, that is what she uses as the word. Lord, help me. It's interesting, this phrase that's used there to describe her kneeling down, it's the word for worship. It's what the Magi did when they came from the east and they brought gifts and they were there to give them to Jesus. And what does it say they did? They knelt down and they worshiped him and they presented their gifts to him. It's what the disciples did after the resurrection. He's about to ascend back up into heaven and they're there and they see him. And what do they do is they see him, they kneel and they worship Jesus. It's what Satan wanted from Jesus when he's tempting him out in the wilderness. He says, come on, Jesus, just kneel to me. It's easy, Jesus. You know, like this, Jesus, let me show you. You know, there you go. Simple as that. Just do that to me, Jesus, and I'll give you everything. It's what Jesus described when he was talking to the Samaritan woman. And she gets into this discourse because she's uncomfortable with the conversation because he's really talking to her about her life and her sin. And she says, well, where are we supposed to worship? You say we're supposed to worship in Jerusalem, and our people say we're supposed to worship here, and where are we supposed to do that? And Jesus responds from John chapter 4, our ancestors worshiped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem. Woman, Jesus replied, believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the spirit and in truth. And in every one of those, guess what he's saying? They will kneel before me in spirit and in truth. The woman, this non-Jew, Canaanite, a worshiper of multiple gods, despised by Jews, is kneeling and worshiping. Lord, Lord, help me. How's Jesus respond? Well, let me quote one thing from Spurgeon. He says, she thought great thoughts of Christ. It was a very great thing to her, but she had a high esteem of Christ. She said, it's nothing to him. It is but a crumb for Christ to give. This woman is persistent with Jesus. She's going to worship Jesus because she believes he's the hope for her daughter. Verse 26, Jesus replied, it's not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. How would you like it if somebody called you a dog? Might get you a little bit riled up. Because that's what he's basically saying to her. It's not right for me to give you something. You're a dog. But we probably need to be a little bit more aware of the word dog that's being used here. Because there's two different words for dogs. There's the dogs that run the street. We have a few of them up here, right? They go out, they do whatever they want to do. They make messes. They take your trash can and knock it down. They take to pull the stuff out and you have to clean it up. And that's not just the bears, it's the dogs too. Okay. And so they're dogs. They're wild dogs. They're ravenous dogs. They're disliked dogs. They're dirty dogs and mangy dogs. That's not the word that's used here. The word that's used here, and this one still surprises me, is for a little pup, a little dog. We have a noisy little dog, our son does, I should say. A noisy little dog, but it's a pet, okay? Now, Marley can be fun, but boy, when he's barking, oh my goodness, I do not like it. Okay, but that's what these were. These were the little pets that were in the house. They're the dogs that you have in your home. How many of you have a dog? Just so I know. Yeah, okay. This is your dog. This is your dog. And what is your dog? How many of you feed your doggy something from your table? Naughty, naughty. Because they come back for more, don't they? Okay. Well, and not only that, how many of you do those dogs sit there around the table, even if you don't give them something, waiting for what? for you to make a mess and spill something that they'll help clean up because they're so loving and kind, right? Well, that's the word that Jesus is using here. And so you almost can picture Jesus having kind of a snicker on his face. Well, ma'am, we don't give the bread from the children to the dogs, to the puppies, to our pets, do we? Ah, but she says, oh, but Jesus. And now this woman, in all of the despair she's feeling, all the pain and the anguish and the frustration and the please, please pleading that she's giving to Jesus, she has her own sense of humor, doesn't she? She has her own pleasant side. Well, yes, but Jesus, Lord, because she, I don't even think she knows his name. Lord, but even the pet dogs get the crumbs that fall off the table. And maybe some of the stuff that the master gives them. So, how does Jesus respond? You need to see that this woman is coming in humility, isn't she? Because notice, what do you mean calling me a dog? I'm not a dog. How rude can you be, you stupid Jew? No, she doesn't do that, does she? In fact, if anything, she accepts it. You're right. I'm just a little pet puppy dog. And like that little pet puppy dog, I really want something from the master. And I'll wag my tail and I'll put up my ears and I'll smile and laugh and get close and lick their cheek and everything if they'll just let me have some of that food off the table. And Jesus has to chuckle because this woman in humility has come to him. She's acknowledged, yes, I am just a puppy dog, but please, please heal my daughter. Let a little crumb, that's all it has to be, just let a little crumb fall off the table so that she can be healed. And what did Peter say in 1 Peter 5? Humble yourself under God's mighty hand that in due time he may lift you up. Cast your anxieties on him because he cares about you. And that's what this woman's doing. She's humbling herself, not humiliating. She's humbling herself. She's admitting, yeah, I'm nothing special. I'm just a little puppy dog, but will you please let me have the crumb? And humility opens the throne room of God, folks. If we're going to become real prayers that make a difference in our world, and this is dads and moms, grandpas and grandmas, single parents, non-parents, kids and all, if we're going to become prayers like this woman, we need to come with humility before God, believing that God's going to respond. Then Jesus said to her, woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted, and her daughter was healed at that moment. Mark tells us the story that Jesus says to the woman, you have great faith. Go home to your daughter. And when she gets there, she's already been healed. The daughter's already gotten the crumb off of Jesus' table. The woman has her faith strengthened and emboldened in front of God. She didn't know who Jesus was, but she had faith anyways. May I point this out? Most of you know Jesus personally. Most of you would call yourselves a Christ one, a Christian. Do you have the faith that this woman had? Who doesn't even know Jesus, just about, but she has faith that if she can just make her plea to him, that he'll give her what she needs. Do we have faith when God is silent? Do we have faith when God says no? Jesus said, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened unto you. And just before he went to the cross, he told his disciples this, John 16:24, until now you've not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you will receive, and your joy will be complete. Verse 26, in that day you will ask in my name. I am not saying that I will ask the Father on your behalf. No, the Father himself loves you because you have loved me and have believed that I came from God. You remember the story of Jacob? He's wrestling with God, and really, actually God's been wrestling with him all his life, or I should say Jacob's been fighting God all of his life. They're wrestling through the night. They're at the river Jabbok. He's afraid that his brother's going to kill him the next morning. He's sent all kinds of offerings, including all of his wives and all of his kids and all of his cattle, across to meet his brother. And now he's preparing to meet his brother. And he wrestles with God, and it ends in a draw. And God's about to leave. And Jacob grabs a hold of him and finally prays, "I'm not going to let you go until you bless me." And that's what God has been waiting for Jacob's entire life. For Jacob to seek his blessing from God, not on his own conniving, lying, deceitful, trickery ways. He wants God's blessing, and God has been longing to give it to him. Mom, God's listening. Moms, God's listening. God's hearing you. Sometimes we wonder, we're pleading, "Please, God, please do this." God's listening. He's hearing. Do you remember Hannah? She's desperate for a child. Peninnah, oh my, is nasty and making it rough every year as they go to the temple. And she's found one day in the temple, and Eli's listening to her, and in her deep anguish, Hannah prayed to the Lord, weeping bitterly. Hannah was praying in her heart, and her lips were moving, but her voice was not heard. Eli thought she was drunk. "Not so, my Lord," Hannah replied. "I am a woman who's deeply troubled. I have not been drinking wine or beer. I was pouring out my soul to the Lord." Mom, Jesus is listening. James 5:16, I may paraphrase it. Moms, the prayer of a righteous mom is powerful and effective. Proverbs 15:29, the Lord is far from the wicked, but he hears the prayer of the righteous. 1 Peter 3:12, for the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Mom, Jesus is listening. Did you hear how I started the message? I think it was the second point. We need more prayers